Amen, amen, amen. It's Sunday, y'all, and we're excited once again. God has a word in store for you today. I'm even going to tell you what it is ahead of time. Turn to your neighbor. Look, we're going to teach. We're going to unpack his word. He's going to speak to us in a great way, and that's why we need for you to stay. Have that 4S experience. Stay with us until the end. God really wants to speak to you today. And so we need for you to stay with us until the end. We want you to create a space where you can hear him, you know, get your notepad, whatever you need to create that space to hear him. Then we want you to save this message, because if you save this message, then you'll be able to go back to it later and re-listen to it, maybe on your ride to work on Monday or on Tuesday, whenever, but you're able to go back and listen to it again. And if this message blesses your life, share this message. And I just believe that you already know that there's something on the inside saying, you know what, I had things to do, but I need to stay for this. Go ahead and hit that share button. Throw some likes on there. Throw some hearts on there. Share this word of God. If you press that share button, you are spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. So go ahead and hit that button to invite somebody else to church. We're excited for what God is about to do. Let's go into the word. Bless the Lord, everybody. We're excited about Jesus. We're excited about getting into this word. We pray that you've been blessed already and that you are ready to receive what God has to say to you. I believe that this word is going to bless your life. I believe that this word is tailor-made for you as you're getting ready to hear what the Lord has to say to you. We're coming from Luke chapter 10. We're going to look at verse 25 through 29. We're not going to just stay there, but that's going to be the overarching scripture that we're going to use to walk out what God has for us. Luke chapter 10, verse 25. I'm going to read 25 through 29, and then we're going to go to work together in the word. 25 says this, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Verse 26, he said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? Verse 27, and he answered, saying, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. Verse 28, and he said unto him, Thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live. 29, but he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, Who is my neighbor? I want you to pray with me under the topic today of turn to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor. And I just really want to dig into this. I believe that this message is going to be really powerful, going to open our eyes, and that God's going to do great things through his word. Can we pray together? Father, I thank you for the opportunity to preach your word. I thank you for the opportunity to share your word. God, it's your word. It's your word. Nothing else, nothing more, nothing less. It is your word. And so, God, we ask that your word will resonate in our hearts, that even if I preach something, Father, that it may not be necessarily what they need, as in the human characteristics of trying to deliver your word in perfection the way that you perfectly have written it. But God, I thank you for the Holy Spirit tailor making it in between the lips of my mouth and their ears, God, that it will hit their heart just right, because your Holy Spirit got all up in the mix. So, Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you that we're going to go out here and be your hands and feet to bless the lives of many because of what you're doing in our hearts. We thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. This season has been one that has impacted us in great ways. You know, we thought some things were just going to be locked up in 2020, and we found that some of those things followed us into 2021. You know, at New Year's, we thought we were going to have a mask burning ceremony where we wouldn't have to wear masks anymore in public areas and different things like that. But some of the things from 2020 that started in 2020 followed us into 2021. One of those things being services. You know, churches are working to figure out what they're going to do in the next step. And as things are starting to reopen, what are the regulations and how we can do things safely, and watching the different things in the news and all that kind of stuff, and figuring out what does church look like on the other side of this. But I want to challenge you today that the church is going to look the same way it did before, because the church was never about the building. The church was not only about the gathering, but the church is on the move. The church is something that can't be stopped. The church is something that is alive and well. The church is something that was functioning all the way through quarantine. The church is something that is powerful. The church is something that is beautiful. And if we didn't really get the picture of the fact that the church is not the building, the church is not the Sunday gathering, then we missed the whole thing of the last season. I can't let you go by and not pick up all the pieces and get all the context and get all the content of what it means to be the church. Because if we go back to doing things the way they were, then we missed a great learning point. We missed a great opportunity to understand to the fullness of what Jesus has called us to do. If the church is just a gathering, if the church is just Sunday, then we are nothing more than any other organization that gets together to have meetings and retreats and all that kind of stuff. But the church is powerful. The church changes lives. The church changes destiny. The church changes what goes on inside of the life of someone from an eternal perspective. The church is something that is so powerful that it cannot be contained. The church is what we are part of. The church is on the move. The church is something that we cannot stop. It's not something that we can contain. The church is on the move. And sometimes we wonder, what is our part in that? What are we supposed to be doing? What is my purpose? What is my thing? What is my gifting? What is my strength? What am I supposed to be doing right now? That every human being on this earth is looking to find that authentic voice, that their thumbprint, the fact that they were here on earth, that they didn't just live from this date to that date, but they have left an impression. They have left an impact on this earth. Every human being wants to leave something that outlives them. You may be wondering sometimes what that thing is, or you might be at a place where you know exactly what that thing is, and you're moving in it and you're flowing in it, and it's powerful and that's amazing. But I found that even in my life, there has been some seasons where I knew exactly where to step, knew exactly what to do. And then there were some times where I wasn't sure. There became a fork in the road. Should I go this way? Should I go that way? And it's a season thing, you know, where you have seasons where you know exactly how things are going to flow, and you got seasons where you are stepping and you're moving and you're wondering if you're making the right decision, but God is leading you and you are stepping into what God has called you to. You got to understand that God is faithful in every season. Through the ups, he's faithful. Through the downs, he's faithful. When I'm on top of the mountain, when I'm in the valley of the shadow of death, he's faithful. When I know how things are going to play out and when I don't know, he's faithful. And I got to keep on walking and keep on staying focused and doing what God has called us to do. And so no matter what season you find yourself in, I need for you to realize that God is faithful. And if you're in a season right now where you feel low, you feel under the pressure of things, you feel like, I don't know what to do. I don't even know if I have purpose. This is where you need, you know, see, the body of Christ is not an individualistic kind of organization. The body of Christ is not an individualistic, like just a place where you're supposed to function by yourself. You need to have that circle around you. Jesus rolled with 12. You need to have a circle around you that will speak encouragement and life into you in the season in which you feel like there is no hope. That you got to have a circle around you that will remind you of what God said, that will remind you of his word, that will build you up, that will cultivate that faith that has kind of come up on the inside of you. You need that circle around you that will pour into you and begin to encourage you to press on. And realize that God has not forgotten you. And see, there's a rhythm to this life where God has a way of exposing you to something and then gives you time to learn that thing and then place you in that thing. He'll expose you to another level. He'll expose you to a level of anointing. He'll expose you to a level of worship. He'll expose you to a level of revelation. He'll expose you to the next step, and then he'll give you time to move in it, to understand, to look at it, to process, and then God will call you to be active in it. Some of the people who serve here at Relevant Church, they got exposed to what God was doing here, and then they got to get in it, and then they got to learn it a little bit, and now God is using them to pour back out. For some people, and for some people who have accepted Christ, God exposed you to the love and grace and mercy and favor and blessing that he had for you, and what Jesus had done to you on the cross, done for you on the cross with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you got exposed to it, and then you got time to look at it, and then you accepted it, and you got into it, and you began to read your word and learn your word, and now he's using you as a tool in it. There's a rhythm that I found that happens in life where there is that exposure, that time for study and learning, and then there's the test. And you may find yourself in a test situation right now where you feel like the teacher is silent, but the teacher teaches before the test. He exposes you to things before the test. He gives you the material before the test, but when the test happens, the teacher goes silent. He's still in the room, she's still in the room, but the teacher is silent. Because now it's time for you in the part of the rhythm to now show what you have absorbed and have come to the knowledge of, because it's time for you to show up. The teacher showed up first, but now it's time for you to show up. The teacher gave you the material and exposed you to something that you didn't know, and maybe you thought you weren't even qualified for, but he started to teach you and you started to embody it, and now it's time for you to show up. And you may be in the season where God has shown up, but now it's time for you to show up, and you feel like God's supposed to be doing something and he's waiting on you to move. And you say that I'm not ready, but a good teacher won't give a test that the student's not ready for, because they have already taught. And they have prepared, and they have exposed, and they have given you the material, and they have given you the exposure, and taught you and broke it down for you. And now they're saying you're ready for the test, and now I'm going to give you this test, and I'm going to go silent. God is silent in your life right now. I challenge you to look to see if there's something that you need to do. Because from what I understand, God is faithful. He's the Lord who will provide. He's the Lord who is faithful. He is the one who is always there. He never leaves you nor forsakes you. So he hasn't abandoned you. Maybe it's time for you to show up in this situation. And so as you find yourself processing and going through this season and how things have been shut down and things have turned this way and that way, you understand that you may not fully know what your purpose is, but you know there are some things that touch you in a certain place that you can't ignore. For some of the things people see, the hate in the media, and it touches them in a place that they can't ignore. For some people, they see hurt when it comes to family members, and it touches them in a place that they can't ignore. Some people see broken marriages, and it just touches them in a place that they can't ignore, and children and broken homes. And when they see it, it just touches them in a place, and they can't ignore it. The misuse of finances, the lack of finances just activate something on the inside of you, and you feel like you want to launch into action, or you see somebody with wasted potential and you look at them and say, you have so much to offer the world and I need for you to do what God has called you to do. People who don't believe in God and people who are hurt by the church, and they begin to share what they've been through, and your heart cries out for them, and you can't ignore it, and you can't turn it off, and you think about it later. You got people who are coming up and they're fighting for things, and they're the underdog, and the odds are against them, and something about it on the inside of you just latches on and wants to push them even forward. And you see the horrible things that go on, those serving time unjustly, or the government policies and local and federal, and maybe policies on your job, and you just can't turn it off because there's something on the inside that says, I need to do something about this. And you just see things, whether it be in the media or local, or just as you go through life, and you see it and you can't turn it off because something on the inside just moves you to do something about it. Somebody say amen. It's the fact of the matter. Mine may not be yours and yours may not be mine, but there's something that when I see it, I can't turn it off because God has called me to make a difference in that area. And though it may not be the same area that you have, there's something that I can't turn off on the inside. And that, my friend, is purpose. That, my friend, is calling. That, my friend, God has birthed something on the inside of you that's supposed to make an impact. And God has drawn you, your attention to those things for a reason. And so those feelings arise when you see them. But it can't just stop at feelings, because when I see certain things, I get angry. When I see certain things, I feel hurt. When I see certain things, I feel this and I feel that. But it can't just stop at a feeling, because feelings are one thing, but the change is going to happen when we activate love on the inside of us. Ain't nothing wrong with being angry. The Bible says, be angry and sin not. Anger may get you to a place where you realize you need to do something, but the activation piece has to be love, because all things through us must be done in love. If it's done because of self, then it ain't it. It has to be done because of love. In Christ, God is love. And so when we started that God-centric point, and out of that relationship comes action, then we come out of love. And though they may not understand, we're coming out of love. And though they may not agree, we're coming out of love. Because at the end of the day, it's about where my starting point was. And if my actions come from the place of love, then all of a sudden God's plan is being done in the earth. Oh, y'all, come on, come on, come on. And see, the fact of the matter is that there is no shortage of information in this world. We got Google, we got Siri, we got Bixby, we got all these different things, and information, Alexa, you can ask her a question and she will tell you right away. There is no shortage of information in this world, but there is a huge shortage of application in love. If we had more people who would apply the word of God to their life and walk it out in love and not just dominance, and not just trying to turn somebody to do things the way they want to do it, but walk it out in the purest of love, we would see transformation happen like never before. There's no shortage of information, but there is a shortage of application in love. Somebody say love. And so he's asking him, how can I have this eternal life, Jesus? What is the main commandment that I need here? And he tells him, they're talking about loving your neighbor and with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength and all these different things. And he says it. And then I love Jesus because he looks at him, and like a good teacher, I believe he realizes that he don't fully get it yet. He don't fully understand this. Jesus begins to teach on. In verse 30, it says this, and Jesus answered, said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. He says that a certain man was on a journey, on a destination, and fell among thieves. These thieves stripped him of his clothes and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. There are some people that we come across in our experience that, because of what happened to them, they have fell to this place. The one thing I want you to understand is that this man had a destination. The only reason he came across these is because he was moving forward. He was headed somewhere and something happened to him en route. Have you ever been en route somewhere and things happened to you that were unexpected? You ever been in a route somewhere and your destiny was great, but something happened to you along the path and you find yourself in a situation you never thought of? And this man was on his way to a destination and he fell among thieves, which stripped him of his clothes, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Have you ever felt half dead? Have you ever felt like I was on my way to greatness, but because of the financial crisis that happened, because COVID hit when it hit, because things did happen the way they happened, and because I thought this was going to work out and it didn't, that I haven't given up all the way, but I just feel half dead. They took from me what I had on my way to the journey, and I can't give up. I'm not fully dead, but I feel half dead. You ever felt half dead. We're hurt with so much where you thought that it was just too much to bear, but something on the inside wouldn't let you quit. Something on the inside wouldn't let you die. Something on the inside said, look, I know you're going through pain, but you're not all the way gone. You're only halfway gone. And I'm telling you today that God can take what you have, even if it's half of you left, even if it's half the drive that you had at first, even if it's half the finances that you had at first, even if it's half the relationships that you had at first, it's if half the congregation you had at first, that God can use what's half dead and bring that thing back to full life. If Jesus was fully dead and he raised them back up, then half dead ain't no problem. Somebody put your hands together right there and give God a praise. Is the fact that we find this man right here, he fell in pursuit of something. Good, bad, or indifferent, he had a destination. And it's something that God wants to do in you. And you find yourself moving towards a destination, and there are challenges that arise, but I want you to understand that God is still faithful in the challenges. God is still faithful in the things that you face. God is still faithful even though bad things happen to you. God is still faithful even though you didn't have what everybody else had. God is still faithful even though you were pressing and you didn't know how it was going to work out and this happened and that happened. God is still faithful, and he's faithful. He will never leave you. Just like this man right here. Verse 31 says this, and by chance there came down a certain priest that way. And when he saw him, the man that had been beaten and wounded and stripped, the priest, he passed by on the other side. The priest passed by on the other side. I'm not talking about just no regular priest. The priest passed by on the other side. I like to call this priest Rev Showless. We talking about Pastor Pete. I'm talking about the fact Rev Showless is the fact that on Facebook, you had this at one point on the timeline, you scrolling through and you see something that really rubbed you the wrong way or something that you don't want to really deal with right now and you don't want to see it on your timeline no more. You could press a little button at the top and click show less. And that way, you didn't have to deal with it. You don't have to see it. It doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. It just means that you don't got to see it and you don't have to deal with it. So you just hit show less. And when you hit show less, now it brings it away from your vision so you don't have to deal with it. And many times we walk through life with that button around where someone is going through something, somebody is facing something, and because we don't want to deal with it right now, we just click the show less button. And even though it's not truly a button, this is what we do. We just pray about it and we move on because we don't want to deal with it, because we don't want to deal with them, because we don't want to put the time in with them. We don't really want to slow down our lives to the point where we actually work with them, even though we may feel called to it. It's out of our comfort zone. It costs too much. It takes too much of my time. I don't really rock with that person. So we just hit show less. And this priest walked by on the other side. Makes me think sometimes, what was so important that this priest walked by on the other side? And why does Jesus identify him as a priest? Because the fact of the matter is sometimes we can be so focused. Yes, I said we, as in the church, can be so focused on the things that we have to do for God that we miss the opportunity to be his representative. I'm gonna say it again, that sometimes we get focused on the things that we do for God that we miss the opportunity to be his representative, to be his hands and feet. That I gotta get to church so that I can serve him, but I'm gonna be rude to the person that I deal with in the morning because they're holding me up from getting to a place where I can celebrate the God that's given me an opportunity to touch somebody's life. And I know I miss preaching to people. I miss seeing you sitting right there, and I miss seeing you sitting right there, and I miss the conversations we would have after church and the worship experience, but we can't get to a place where we're the priests and we're so worried about the experience that we miss the opportunity to be his representative. You see, that the church gathering was something that was birthed out of the church on the move. that Jesus was touching so many lives that people just found him in houses, found him on the mountain, found him on a boat, found him as he moved through. That's how the gathering began to happen. They found him as he was being effective, and the church is on the move. The church is touching lives. The church is, it needs to be out here ministering to people. And sometimes we want to be so together, which is not a bad thing, but we can't miss the opportunities to be his representatives at the expense of just doing what we like. But we got to remember that Christ has called us to further the gospel message. And the gospel message has to go to all the ends of the earth, to those who are non-believers. And yes, I love worshiping with believers. Yes, I love the opportunity for us to gather and lift his name up together. But there's so much more to be done. Let us not be the priest that passed on the other side because we had something else to do that we thought was more important. Verse 32 says this, and likewise, a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. He came and he looked on him. He came and he looked on him, saw what he was going through, got the details, examined him a little bit, and then left on the other side. The one who had information, but no application. Gathered the information of what was going on in the situation, but was not called and was not moved to do something about what he was going through. You ever have people who call you, what's going on with such and such? Yeah, such and such, she's going through a hard time, and she's going through this, and then, can you tell me more about it? Can I get the detail? Okay. So we're going, I ain't got time to deal with that. Boom, boom, boom. Gather all the information, not to do something about it, not to be activated, but just to know. Oh, it's a grown-up word today. Came and got all the details and decided to run off. A man of knowledge, but no action. We have to make this word real in our hearts. We got to make this word come alive. The Bible talks about, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us. We got to make this word flesh. We got to make this word something that people can see. We got to make this word undeniable in our lives, because this word is powerful. Ain't nothing wrong with his word. When we begin to walk it out, people will see. They will be impacted. They will see the God's love. They will feel God's love. And they will see the fact that even though you're not perfect, but there's something working on the inside of you that is transformative. And I need some more of that in my life. And they may not know how to describe it correctly. They may say it's a vibe that you bring. They may say it's the energy that you carry. They may say it's just a feeling that I get when I'm around you. But the fact of the matter is, it's the Holy Spirit activating his word on the inside of me that's touching your life and the love of God. I'm just a conduit. I'm not that love. I'm not that Christ, but I'm a conduit of his love. And as I touch your life, you get connected to power and the Holy Spirit begins to flow through you. And now all of a sudden you realize that that's truth. That's power. That's love. That's something that I need in my life. And I'm pointing you to Jesus so you can get it for yourself, because you can have your own direct connection. But if we just gather information and don't have the application, don't have the discipline, don't have the consistency to walk this thing out, then we just gathering information but not seeing the change. And God wants more. He wants to do more than you just gathering information. In 33, it says, but a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. the least out of the three that wouldn't even be dealing with him, saw him and had compassion on him as he journeyed. God will show you something on the move, and he will show you people on the move, and he'll connect you to people when you want to move. That's why you got to get started, because as you move, you'll see things. As you move, opportunities will come. As he journeyed, he came across this man. If he had never left his house, he would have never been there. And he journeyed and he came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. Y'all, I'm trying to teach this thing, but the preacher coming out. The fact of the matter is that that word compassion means to be moved from your bowels, from the inner part, the deeper end, the deepest part of you. He began to be moved from that place. That was a sympathy, there was a love, there was a pity for the situation that he was coming through, that moved him from the inside out. That moved him. And see, that's that deep calling. That's that thing that you can't turn off. That's that thing that when you see it, all of a sudden, all of you begins to move. All of you begins to realize that I have to do something about this. And this is what the church should carry. This is that level of sensitivity that we got to turn on in the church. The level of sensitivity in the spirit that will see somebody and be moved from the inside out, that you can't ignore it, that God will have such a hand on you that when you see them, that you feel what they feel, that you see what they're going through, to the place where it almost takes your breath away, because the Holy Spirit has residence in your life so much that when you see them, even though they didn't say nothing to you, you can feel what they're going through. And God is calling the church to be active, that as you move through the grocery store, that you would be in such a mind of prayer, and that you'll be so sensitive to the Spirit that you can walk by somebody who's standing up, but you see their wounds. That you can pass by somebody who seems put together, but you can see the hurt. That you can pass by somebody who looks like they're just the perfect little person, and you can see what they're going through, because God has increased the sensitivity of the Spirit on the inside of you. And he saw this man. He was moved with compassion deep down to his core. Deep down to his core. The church has to feel again. The church has to be sensitive to the Spirit again. The church, I would love for someone to tell me, look, I was on my way, Pastor, and I knew I was supposed to greet, and I knew I was supposed to play, and I knew I was supposed to sing, but the Holy Spirit wouldn't let me walk past this person. The Holy Spirit had me pouring out into this person, and the Holy Spirit has me praying for this person, and this, that, whatever, because that is the church. I'm not saying deny your obligation, and yes, there's people counting on you, and yes, there's logistics to this, and yes, there's logistics to that, but we can't miss the fact that those things are things that we do to serve God. And as God begins to birth things on the inside of you, I know you're looking for when church is going to happen on the inside, but I'm waiting for the calls that say, Pastor, we had church at the house, and guess what? My neighbor got saved, and my cousin got saved, and I know they would never come to church, but we had a watch party at our house, and we praising the Lord, and we lifting them up, and we glorify him, and great things are happening at my house, and things are happening in my backyard, and guess what? We pulled up at the park, and we had this, and things are happening at the park, and just see the transformation. Look, we were watching things over brunch, we were watching things over dinner, and God just began to move powerfully. That I know church is gonna open at some point, but when I come back, when we do open up, I got 30 folks that's been coming to my house, and we ain't got enough seats for them, but God is doing things in the house. Don't you realize that God will do things if you allow him to use what you have? The Samaritan did not, he wasn't the richest person, he wasn't a person who had an overwhelming level of wealth. He wasn't even someone who we would have thought would have stopped, but he's the one who was moved with compassion. If God does something on the inside of you where you are so moved to act, then God will give you what you need as you begin to do what he said. God will give you what you need as you begin to do what he said. And the Samaritan goes over. He's moved with compassion. I can see him walking up saying, I don't really know how we're going to do this thing, but I'm going to go to him. I don't even know if he wants to to hear it from me. I don't even know if he wants me to touch him, but here's the fact of the matter. I'm so moved that I can't ignore it. So I'm going to go move his way. In 34, it says, and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. Will you allow God to interrupt your plan? Will you see? And I'm a planning person and I get it. I got this happened on a Monday and this happened on Tuesday and this happened on Wednesday. But this one right here decided the fact that, look, I'll let God interrupt my plan. I was on the journey, but once I found an opportunity to be his hands and feet, I put him on my beast and I took him to an inn and to take care of him. And verse 35 says this, on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said to him, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Look, I may not have all the resources, but what I have, I will give to you, and I will take you to who you need. I may not be a counselor, but I sure will take you to one. I may not be a preacher, but I sure take you to one. I may not be a pastor, but I sure take you to one. I may not be a grocery store, but I sure take you to one and get you what you need, even if I'm not the one. Because maybe the fact of the matter, you're scared about being God's hands and feet because you don't feel like you have enough. You don't feel like you have the answers. You don't feel like you're eloquent enough. But the fact of the matter is that God may have you as a connection. Maybe you may not be the one who can give them the finances, but maybe you're the one who can grab hold of them and grab hold of someone who does and make the connection so that they can get what they need. And he took them to the inn. He said to the host, take care of him. Look, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay you. Verse 36, which now, it says, which now of these three thinkest thou was the neighbor unto him that fell among thieves? Verse 37, and he said, he that showed mercy on him. Then Jesus said unto him, go and do likewise. We must see the issues that are around us and the things that moved us from deep down with me and understand that God has ordered our steps and we must step in his will and do what he's called us to do, that we have to show compassion and it will require us to develop a plan and execute. He took what he had in the moment and did the best he could, but he also developed a plan and executed it. See, sometimes we do what we can in the moment, but then we just leave it. But we got to develop a plan and execute it so that there can be a sustaining factor. He says, look, I can take care of you for this moment. I can't leave you where you are, and I will connect you to help that can help you. And so this help will help you, and then I will come back and check on you. And sometimes it's a simple plan like that will be transformative in somebody's life, because the fact of the matter is that he was on his way to a destination the same way that he was on the way to a destination. And so by the grace of God, he didn't fall amongst these, but it could have been him. And when you realize the fact that someone else is in a situation and you could be in that situation, that you should be moved with compassion. I know you got money right now, but the fact of the matter is things could have happened and it could have been another way. You might have prospered during the COVID season, but it could have been another way. You might have 2 or 3 homes, but it could have been another way. You may not be on a drug addiction right now, but it could have been another way. You must understand that it's only by the grace of God that you are who you are. And truthfully, it's only by the grace of God that we are where we are today. And when we understand that, we're able to extend that grace to our neighbor. Somebody say, turn to your neighbor, turn to your neighbor. The fact of the matter is that you got purpose on your life, and so does a person who's going through a struggle right now. And we must understand and increase our sensitivity to the fact that we have to be God's hands and feet in the earth. You might be saying, Pastor, I need a message that will encourage me. I need a message that will build me up. I need a message that will tell me that everything's going to be all right. I need a message that's going to tell me that God's going to bless me next week. I need a message that tells me that God's going to open the door that no man can close. I need a message that's going to tell me all these different things. And I realize all of that thing. And I realize that. But if you understand the fact that all the things that I just said talked about what God's going to do. And as a father, the things that I'm going to do are independent of the things that my sons are going to do. I'm going to do it because I'm the father. And if they're so focused about what the father is going to do, then they'll spend their attention watching me. And I don't need for them to watch me. I need them to do what they've been called to do. And I'm going to do what I'm called to do because I'm a good father. I wish somebody would get that, is the fact you're so concerned about what God is going to do in your life. God's going to do what God's going to do, but he needs for you to do what you're responsible for doing. And he says, I want you to be my hands and feet. Turn to your neighbor. I know you're concerned about when God's going to open the doors of the church again. And he says, turn to your neighbor. I know you're concerned with when the world is going to open back up again fully. He says, turn to your neighbor. Who is my neighbor? Whoever I put in your path as you're on your journey, I need for you to understand that there are people in your life, that the wisdom that God has allowed you to experience through business, the wisdom that God has allowed you to experience through finance, the wisdom that God has allowed you to experience through the word of God, the wisdom that God has allowed for you to experience through raising children, the wisdom that God has allowed you to experience through walking through challenges, all this stuff that you just think is not important, God is calling you to say, pour out of yourself and begin to pour out on your neighbor. Make a connection. Make the phone call. Send the text message. Who are you pouring into? I know you're looking for somebody to pour into you, but he says, who are you pouring into? You tuned in to church right now and you getting filled up, but who are you pouring into? Who is your mentor? Who is your mentee? Who is someone who depends on you consistently having something for them? God says, you have enough to raise somebody up. This whole thing is about connecting and pouring back out what God has poured into you. There's a flow that happens. Every talk about getting in the flow, but the only way there can be a flow is that what's poured into is being poured out. That creates a flow that as it comes in, this word blessed my life, but it can't just stay with me. I got to find somebody to pour into. And maybe they're younger than you in age, or maybe they're just younger than you in business, or maybe they're younger than you in child raising, or maybe they're even older than you, whoever God calls you. And there's some people who have been connected to you that when you see them and you see them doing wrong and you see them not living to their potential and you see them making financial mistakes and you see them going through this, that you are so moved with compassion that you can't ignore it, that you almost got to hit show less, because if you see it, you're going to be called to it. You're going to be drawn to it. And God is telling you right now, I don't want you to hit show less. I want you to do what I've called you to do. Turn to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor and be moved with compassion. Priest, church person, Levite, church person, but as the one that we didn't expect, that was so moved. You might be saying, look, I ain't this and I ain't that. I ain't got this degree. I don't have that experience. I'm not smart enough. I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I'm the one. I don't like to talk. I don't like to be pulled to the forefront. I don't like, and you have all these different things, and it's, and God says, I understand all that, and I still called you, and I still love you, and I still need you, and you have to begin to pour out of yourself, and though you don't think it's enough, it's more than enough when you start to pour. It's more than enough when you start to open up. And as you start the journey, more opportunities, more resources. Some of us want so much resource. We want this overflow of wealth. We want this overflow of exposure. We want the overflow of following. And God says, why? If you won't pour out where you are right now, there's no need for you to have XYZ. Create a need for me to fill. Preach everything that you got. Leave it on to the point where you say, Lord, you got to fill me up, because I need to be able to do this. The miracle of the multitude, the two fish and the five loaves that was extended was because there were so many people. If there was no need for it to be extended, then it would have stayed two fish and five loaves. What I'm saying is, use what you have and allow God to extend it. I'm living proof of that, y'all. That, Lord, I don't know if I'm ready for this. We'll just start pouring out what you got. And the more that I pour out, the more that he extends. The more I give away what seems like two fish and five loaves, it keeps growing. Every week when we preach, we preach and we say, Lord, you fill us back up. And every week he fills us back up. That even in the COVID season, God is faithful. That if you rise up and start the journey, that God will do everything that he says like this. Look, if you have vision and it's centered on God, he will bring provision. We're looking for the provision. He says there's no reason for provision without a vision. It's a vision for your life, vision for your family, vision for your career path, vision for the ministry, vision for the business, vision for your legacy. He says, create that and provision will come. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you and I bless your name for those who are watching today. And I ask you, Lord, to just pour out your Holy Spirit like never before upon them, upon their family, upon their world. Place angels of protection all around them as they move about, as they make decisions, as they realize who their neighbor is, realize that you will fill them up again. They will never run on empty. But as they pour out, you're filling them back up. Give them boldness. Give them compassion. Increase their sensitivity in the spirit to a place where they can feel what you've called them to do. God, we thank you for the greatness that you've allowed for them to experience thus far. And Lord, we ask that you will continue to bless them in a great and mighty way. If you're watching and you want to accept Jesus Christ into your heart today, it's the best decision that you could ever make. And he wants you to start this journey with him. And I want you to repeat this prayer after me. This prayer will start you on that journey. He came, saw you wounded, saw you battered, saw you bruised. He came over, bandaged you up, showed you love. And it wasn't because you were so good, but it was because of his grace that you're able to heal, that you're able to grow, that you're able to be saved and experience the best that God has for you. If you want to receive that today, simply repeat this prayer after me. Say, Dear Jesus, come into my heart and save me. I believe that you died on the cross for my sin, and I accept you into my heart. I renounce Satan. I believe you're alive today. Make my salvation real to me and lead me by your Holy Spirit. Before we say amen, I want to pray for some others. God, thank you for those who need deliverance in their life, who've been going around the same cycle, around and around again. God, but I thank you that you're breaking the power of that negative cycle off their life, and that the exit sign is being illuminated, and that they're changing, God, that they're changing, that discipline, accountability, that the spirit of love, joy, power, sound mind is just a part of them now in the name of Jesus. Allow them to find a circle that will encourage them and keep them away from the cycle that had them bound. God, we ask for healing power to flow now in the name of Jesus from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. We understand that healing is the children's bread, and we claim it to be so. We claim it to be true. We claim to be activated in the life of everyone who is listening under the sound of my voice. Let your perfect plan be done in their life. And we thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name, the church said, amen. Can we give God a praise right there? Put those hands together and bless him, lift him up, glorify his holy and righteous name, for he is a great God, he's a mighty God, and he's worthy to be praised. Amen. Amen. We're excited for you. We're excited for what God is doing in your life. We believe God has done great things. And if you want to connect with this ministry, especially if you just accepted Jesus, you need to do this. Text REL CHURCH to 54244 so that you can stay connected and updated, and God can do great things in your life as you make the connection, because it's not about being an individual, it's a part about being a part of the body of Christ. And we want to connect with you, and we want to make sure that you get what you need and stay updated with what's happening here at Relevant. We also would love for you to give if you want to give, if you feel so moved to give. And God does great things through your giving. He allows us to begin to touch lives and pour out and go and be his hands and feet in the earth. And so we would love for you to sow into the ministry. God will do great things through your gifts. And as you give, someone else is getting blessed, and God promises to give back to you. Pressed down, shaking together, and running over. And so I believe that God will do great things through your giving today. And so we're excited about what God is doing. We're excited about what God is going to do in your life. And I believe that you're going to turn to your neighbor, and we're going to hear testimonies of the fact that I didn't think that God could use me this way. I didn't think that what I had was so valuable. I didn't think that what he was doing inside of me was enough, but look at the fruit. Look at what God is doing. Look at the healing that has happened. Look at the people who have changed. Look at the body of Christ growing. And then when we all come back together again, boom, God has done great things. And we see the picture of heaven singing his praises, the picture of heaven lifting him up. Not because our flyer was so good, not because our flyer was so good, not because the video was great, but because he used you as you turn to your neighbor to create a relationship and pour in them the gospel of Jesus Christ and cultivate it, what he's called us to do. And then we get together and we have a mini heaven celebration on earth and lift up our King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm excited, y'all. But we pray that you have a great week, and God is going to do great things through you as you turn to your neighbor. We are centered on God, declaring his truth while living in faith. He is relevant. You are relevant. We are relevant. God bless you.